Hello everybody and welcome to Warhammer Online Return of Reckoning, the private server. Today we're going to be looking at the campaign maps and the OpenRVR and how they work. The campaign maps, there are three of them, one for Dwarves and Greenskin, one for Empire and Chaos, one for High Elves and Dark Elves. So we're going to start with the Empire one because I'm there. The top locations is usually the locations that order flies into, and the bottom ones are usually the ones destruction side flies into. Now today we are in Northland. This is a tier 1 map, and what I want to do is I want to explain to you how the campaigns work. The game originally had 4 tiers, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 and tier 4, as you can see here. You can still see them, but on Return of Reckoning there are 2 tiers. There's tier 1 and everything else has been merged together. So tier 1 is a self-contained tier, meaning it does not affect the other 3 tiers. Tier 2 affects tier 3, tier 3 affects tier 4, and tier 4 affects tier 5, which we'll see a little bit later. So let's take them from the beginning and let's see how we play a tier 1 campaign map. First of all, you gotta go to the map using the flight masters and then you enter the PvP area. Once you do, the game will level you up to level 16 on tier 1. So-called bolster, so your statistics go up, your HP will go up. As you can see, I just got 2100, so you can survive here. As you level up, your bolster will start dropping until you reach your normal level. Now most of the maps in tier 1, they have 4 flags. This one has 3. As you can see, they're all locked and they're in the color of order, because order won the map. So this map has 3 flags. In order for you to win this map, you have to go and capture the flags, which is very easy. You just walk up to a flag and you sit next to it. Once you do, the timer on the top right will start, and the more people you have, the faster it will go down, with a maximum of 6 people. That is, if you have 7, it will still be maxed out at 6 people. If you have 100, it won't go any faster. The maximum rate you can have slow down is by 6 people. Once you capture the flag and it becomes your color, then a timer that you will not see will start, and every 2.5 minutes you will have at the bottom of the flag a little box, which is resources, which you can pick up, mount up, and then you ride it all the way back to your war camp. It's going to go and show you the delivery point, and you do that for all 3 flags. The more flags, the more resources you get. So this is what you do on tier 1. You get the resources, you bring them back to this flag here, supply point banner, you right click it, you drop your resource. Now if you are solo, you get renown, XP and influence to the box you deliver. If you're in a party, then you share it with your party. If you're in a warband, you share it with your warband. The people that are in your party or your warband, they have to be near the flag, so all of you have to move together. Now as you can see here on the little add-on that I have for a different area, it says here 24% resources for order and 58% resources for destro. So they are moving boxes all the way through. Now once one of these two sides, order or destruction, reaches 100% resources, then they are ready to lock them up. They are not done yet though. In order to do that, you need to move enough resources, be 100%, and then you need to capture all 3 flags and hold them for 30 seconds. So if you have 2 flags, you cannot lock them up and win. If you have 3, yes, but if you lose one in that 30 second window, you have to recapture one, and that's how you lock the maps. And as I said before, the tier 1 is self-contained, meaning you lock one map, then you move to the next one. So right now Northland is locked, the Elf one is locked, it's order controlled. You put the mouse over, it can tell you, you can see from the signs anyways. And the only one in debate right now is Ekran with Mount Blunthorn, which as you can see says uncontrolled. The fight is there right now. That's the easy way of finding out where the fight is. Until you level up and you go to the higher tiers, tier 2, this is what you do on those maps. Now, when the map locks and you win, your side wins, you will take some extra renown, some extra XP, which helping you level up faster. Now, some people will receive more, some people will receive less. This happens because it depends how much effort you put into the war. How many kills you did, how much you healed, how many people you resurrected, how many flags you captured, how many flags you defended, and so on and so forth. And that is how tier 1 maps work. Now we're going to move to a tier 2 map where the strategies change, there are more things to do in the map. For example, tier 2 maps have castles, they have keeps. In order to win a tier 2 map, you need to capture the enemy keep and then hold the flag. So we're going to have a look at that right now. As you can see, this map is one fort here and one fort here. One of them is located in Ostland. The other one is located in Troll Country. This map is split in two different areas. You can walk through them with no problem, but map-wise, you have to change location. So how do you get to siege the enemy keep? In order to do that, you need to have your cannons, you need to have your sieging rams, and you do this by gathering resources again. The resources on tier 2, tier 3, and tier 4, they work exactly as tier 1. You go to the flag, you capture the flag, you take the resources, and you move them to the drop point location. But instead of taking them to your war camp in tier 2 and the rest that have a keep, you have to take your resources to your keep. This is one of the keeps. Tier 2 is a lower level than tier 4, therefore the keeps are a bit small. So once you have your resources, you come here and you drop them here. You right click, and the same thing applies as tier 1. You get your points, XP, renown, your party does if it's near you, the warband does as well. And as you move along, your keep ranks up, and you can see here, this is a tier 4 map, it has 2 stars. Now you can get all the way up to 5 stars. Every star brings something to the keep. The first star will make the keep lord, what usually sits here, have more life. 2 stars allow you to spawn the ram and the cannon, so you can go and siege the enemy keep. 3 stars on tier 2 just makes you keep your lord a little bit harder to kill, and so on and so forth. However, there is a condition that if you have 5 stars and you hold all flags in the area, you win the map. So this is a different mechanism for winning. You need to take the enemy keep and the 4 flags to win. If you can't, then you need the 4 flags and your own keep to be at 5 stars. It's very hard to keep a 5-star keep because it needs a lot of resources, and you need to supply it constantly because otherwise it deranks. So the chance of you seeing a level 5 keep and winning a map is very slim. In order for you to get a ram and a weapon, there are NPCs inside the keeps which you can buy those things. The ram, you can keep it and use it again and again. The oil and other expendable weapons such as cannons, you cannot. Now, since we're here, let me just show you, in theory, somebody spawns a ram, they bring the ram here, and they start hitting the door, they can put the cannons further back, and the siege begins. As defenders, you can buy oil. Yes, that is right, burning oil. You get a big oil, and you place it right here, I will show you. This is the oil spot. You put an oil here and you start pouring to the attackers below in order to slow them down and destroy the ram. If there is no ram, there is no sieging happening. So you'll see these fights later on. We'll do another tutorial with the live combat and you can see how everything works in reality. And this is tier 2 maps. Now, tier 2 maps are important because they help move the campaign forward. What does that mean? That if we look at the map, for example, Order has locked tier 2, then they locked tier 3, and now they're on tier 4. If tier 2 that we are is not locked, you cannot go and fight on tier 3. So you have to do them progressively from tier 2 to tier 3 to tier 4. And when you go to tier 4, here's where the big fight begins, because this can go either way. The map from tier 2 to tier 3 will progress anyway, whether this is won by Order or Destro, it will move to tier 3. And whether this is won by Order or Destro as well, as long as somebody wins, it goes to tier 4. But on tier 4 is where things really matter. If Destruction wins, then they are pushing the map downwards to Rakeland, and from Rakeland into the forts, into sieging Aldorf itself, the capital from Order. If Order, in this case, won the middle map, it pushes towards Inevitable City, Chaos Waste, the forts, and then Inevitable City, and we can siege as Order the Destruction capital. This is how the campaign moves in relation to who wins what. Now, on tier 3 maps is exactly the same thing, As we've already seen on tier 2, there's one keep, resources, the flags, same conditions for winning apply. The only big difference is that this is a small keep. This is a very small keep. It has one door and one postern. This is the back door of the keep. Attackers can use this if they are melee DPS to, to gain entrance and attack from both sides. On tier 3 though, the keeps become bigger. The maps are bigger, the battles are bigger, and more tactics are required. Sometimes you might need to spawn two rams. If they are destroyed, you have another chance. You can spawn one ram if it's destroyed every 10 minutes, and the defenders can spawn an oil every 2.5 minutes. So we're gonna go to a tier 3 map so I can show you how the keeps look there. The keeps there are bigger, not just in size as a building, but they have an outer wall with an outer door you need to break down. Then you go to the inner keep, another door to break down. So it's a much bigger situation. It does require more people in order to take this one down. Also, all tier 2, tier 3, and tier 4 maps always have 4 flags to play with. And here applies the same thing, guys. We said this before. Capture the flags, move the resources, get your keep to 2 stars so you can spawn the rams and you can spawn the cannons and everything. However, as you can see the keep from here, by the way. It's that big thing over there. You see how big it is? However, on tier 3 and tier 4, the stars matter a lot more because they have more faction. As you can see, the keep, look at the outer wall, how big it is. It is a big keep to siege. If you haven't seen before, I think personally it's quite impressive. So, the stars. I'm going to go through the postern door because it's a bit quicker. I hope this is our keep, yes. Now, the stars here are a little bit different from tier 1. From tier 2. On tier 3, one star makes the Lord harder and the doors to kill. Stars 2, you can bring out the ram and the cannons. 3 stars means that the enemy cannot access the postern. They cannot access the postern on the outer wall. 4 stars means they cannot access the postern on the main gate here. So if the keep reaches 4 stars, they cannot use this door. Doesn't matter what class they are, abilities they have. This door is blocked. That gives the opportunity to defenders to defend better, but only having to defend this door if they make it to the inner without having to worry being attacked from the back. So stars do matter. Out of experience, I would say that most of the times people try and get 2 stars and siege straight away, not giving the opportunity to defenders to build up the stars and make it harder. The rest of the mechanics remain exactly the same. You know, you need to take the keep, the 4 flags, the resources to win that. Now, tier 4 is exactly the same as the tier 3 maps, the same size keeps, big, both walls in and out, and it keeps going like that. There is room in the maps to play as a 6-man. You can solo roam, you can do warbands, which is the more effective one for taking down sieges with the siege weapons and everything. And that's how maps progress. From tier 1, which is self-contained, to tier 2, opening tier 3 maps, and tier 3 to tier 4, all the way up to attacking the main capitals. I will try and make a future tutorial about the forts and explain the mechanics when they're active, because forts I cannot enter unless the campaign moves all the way up there, and we will talk about it later on. I hope you found this information useful to help you understand what you need to do in the maps, how you need to play the maps, and hopefully that will make the game more enjoyable for you. Thank you very much for watching. We'll see you on the next tutorial. I hope everything works out for you.